We can now make a projection in one of the two Georgia Senate runoffs. CNN will now project that Democrat Raphael Warnock is elected to the U.S. Senate. The pastor defeating Republican incumbent Kelly Loeffler. This puts Democrats halfway toward their goal of retaking control of the U.S. Senate. It now all comes down to who wins the other runoff. John Ossoff, who is currently in the lead, or incumbent Senator David Perdue. That is your headline. We are projecting that Raphael Warnock has been elected to the U.S. Senate. Now, the question becomes why and how and what does it mean for the other race? That takes us to John Berman. He came out early and said, thank you, thank you, thank you. I represent everybody. Wasn't premature.
No, he came out for good reason. He's now leading by 40,000 votes. There's more vote to be counted, which likely skews Democratic. Let's just talk about the historic nature of this, first of all. You have an African-American pastor being elected senator from an old South state. That is historic in and of itself, and it puts now the Democrats one vote away from controlling the Senate. That Senate seat is still up for grabs at this point. How did Raphael Warnock do it? He ran ahead of Joe Biden. If Joe Biden's the baseline for Democrats, what you need to do to win in Georgia, Raphael Warnock ran better than Joe Biden in all these counties where there's color. He did it almost everywhere, okay? Particularly, for instance, in a lot of these African-American heavily populated counties here. Look at Bibb County, for instance. He got 62.8% of the vote. I can show you what Joe Biden did, 61.4. Just that little bit of difference in all those places adds up. He was a strong candidate in those areas. He also benefited, frankly, from his opponent. Kelly Loeffler, not as popular. Not as popular as David Perdue. David Perdue, as we said, has actually been elected to the Senate. Kelly Loeffler was appointed by Brian Kemp, the governor there. Had never won an election in Georgia, and that may have hurt her. You can see Raphael Warnock, also Fulton County. Let me just point this out. Raphael Warnock is the Reverend Ebenezer Baptist Church, Martin Luther King Jr.'s and Martin Luther King Sr.'s church. Deep roots in the area, deep roots among black churches, which are so important in Georgia as well. In Fulton County, you can see Raphael Warnock got 72.4% of the vote. Let me compare that, in this case, to David Perdue, to John Ossoff. You can see Raphael Warnock actually got 4,000 more votes in Fulton County than John Ossoff did. So you can see Raphael Warnock overperforming Joe Biden in some cases, and also John Ossoff, who was also running in this election. So a very strong candidacy for Warnock across the state. One other thing I want to point out, because it happened just yesterday, Donald Trump came to campaign against both Democratic senators. This is the county that he went to. Now, you look at this and say, oh, man, Raphael Warnock got shellacked in this county. He just got 29% of the vote. But it wasn't really a change from what happened in the presidential race there. You can see Joe Biden got 29%. So Donald Trump's visit to Whitfield County last night didn't seem to make a huge difference. It didn't necessarily animate Republicans in the numbers that they needed to turn out to overcome what Raphael Warnock was able to do.
You had a super motivated black vote in this state.
Absolutely.
That made a difference in the presidential race and now made a difference in the Senate. I mean, they literally put their hand on history tonight with Warnock, both for what he represents and how he won. I mean, there were a lot of questions about the black vote going into this election, about whether or not they'd come out, whether the Democrats still deserve them. Boy, did they represent.
They came out, and they came out early, which Harry could talk about more in a second if you want. They came out early. They overrepresented in the early vote from what they were projected to do, which
exactly
is also
right.
Which is a huge change.
That's a huge change,
Harry, from previous elections.
That's exactly right. It's a huge change. You go back to the 2008 runoff. Remember, that was a year in which Saxby Chambliss, the incumbent Republican, was forced into a runoff by Jim Martin, the Democrat. And you basically saw in that election black turnout dropping from the general election to the runoff that in that year was held in December. That is clearly not the case this time around. You had large African-American turnout in that black belt running from Augusta down to the southwest portion of the state. But the other thing I'll point out is that Raphael Warnock also did particularly well in those suburban areas. Look at Gwinnett County, for example, where he's up by 21 points right now. That was a county that, if I recall correctly, Mitt Romney carried by 9 points back in 2012. So that's basically a 30-point shift. That just gives you an understanding that those Atlanta suburbs really, really were a big deal in this election, and switching them from Republicans to the Democrats, at least in Raphael Warnock's case.
So let me ask you this, Harry. I also want to bring in Mark Preston and Kirsten Powers. It's good to have you both. Thank you for joining us in this history-making moment. Once again, we're living it together. Harry, you say that the suburbs made a difference, but when you're looking about the headline of this in terms of why this happened tonight, how high on the register of impact are you going to have to put the black vote?
The top. I mean, this was the big question mark heading into this, right? You saw that African Americans in the general election perhaps made up a lower share than they traditionally have. And there was a real question of whether or not black voters were going to turn out. But as John was hinting at, we saw in the early vote that black voters were making up a larger share than they did in the general election at the equivalent points. And although we don't have the exact numbers right now, we'll have to wait and see. At this particular point, if you're looking at where the vote totals were down the least relative to the November elections, it tended to be in those places where African Americans make up a significant either portion or even a majority of the electorate.
Kirsten, huge turnout tonight, not just among black voters, but, you know, that is most notable. But in a runoff election like this, usually a big fall off from the general. And here we're definitely over 4.6 million. You had 5 million in the state during the presidential race. You know, it's really strong turnout. How big a deal is this for the president-elect if both of these races go his party's way?
Oh, I mean, it's really hard to overstate what a big deal it would be if both of these races go his way in terms of governing. But I also think for the Democratic Party, even just with this one race called, it shows us that Biden winning Georgia wasn't an aberration. So it suggests that there is something more going on there, and this could become a state that Democrats could perhaps more, rely on more than they have been able to in the past, because it was always seen as trending in that direction. But now it suggests that maybe there's been some sort of shift, which I think, you know, we have to acknowledge the role that Stacey Abrams has played in this, particularly in terms of really changing how the black turnout has been, both for the president and president-elect and now in this race. So, you know, I think that there are a lot of implications about this for the Democratic Party, and then also, you know, for the president-elect, if he has a sense, if he's in control, basically, if Democrats are in control of, you know, all three parties, I mean, all three branches of government, that's going to radically change how he can govern.
Kirsten, if I can jump in, let me ask you a question, because this became about not the right to vote in Georgia, but the fight to vote in Georgia. I think Democrats made a strategic positive by turning this into when Republicans in Georgia tried to suppress the vote. So what Democrats did was made it about the fight to vote. They're trying to steal your vote. You have people like Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and John Lewis who fought for your right to vote, people who died. And I think that Democrats were able to turn that message over and use the president and also Kelly Loeffler, some of her own words, against her. And that certainly appeared to help them in this race down in Georgia.
Yeah. Is that directed at me, Don?
Yes.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, no, I think that's absolutely right. And I think that, and Kelly Loeffler also, let's remember, made a lot of really, I don't know what the right word for, like low down kind of attacks on Reverend Warnock, you know, really trying to tie him to Jeremiah Wright, trying to, you know, play sort of these sort of, I don't know, racial politics around black churches, which we saw with Jeremiah Wright, and she was doing the same kind of thing with him. And I, you know, it obviously didn't work for her. And then I think we also would be remiss if we didn't talk about Donald Trump's role in all of this, of course. You know, there was a lot of confusion, I think, sent by the Republican Party and by Donald Trump, telling people that you can't trust the vote, you know, so it was sending mixed messages about voting, and then also just creating general chaos around, you know, the check, the $2,000 checks, and then you had, you know, Mitch McConnell denying that. So there just was a lot of chaos created, and then of course, you know, the infamous, you know, phone call that has happened with, you know, with Donald Trump, you know, calling in the day before the election and basically trying to, you know, strong arm an official into helping him steal an election. So he also played a role in this.